EBDMC, there's Devon Seal, Russell Atopy, Anastasia Ranja,
Jennifer Myers,
and Johnny Robinson. Thank you for your patience. It seems we're going to be a small but appreciative audience. So small but appreciative audience, please come closer.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and apologies for our late start. My name is Diego Mileros. I am the lecturer in Spanish here at the CLL, and I also coordinate the Spanish courses that we offer here. And it is my pleasure to welcome you all, and especially our dean, Dr. Heather Cato, our former dean, Professor Ian Robertson, the head of the Department of Modern Languages and Linguistics, Dr. Nicole Roberts, to this public lecture, and also welcome you all as well, and our colleagues here, and the public to this public lecture entitled Identity and Identity Formation in a Globalized and Digitalized Society by our distinguished guest speaker, Professor Kumar. I was going to attempt to say his name, but I changed my mind. As you know, the Center for Language Learning is celebrating its 20 years of service to the UWI campus and the wider community here in Trinidad. And as part of the celebrations that officially started yesterday with our media launch, we are delighted to bring you this thought-provoking lecture relevant to the current field of applied linguistics and particularly to the teaching and learning of foreign languages. After Professor Kumar's address, we will open the floor to a question and answer period and an open discussion. So please take careful note so that you can participate in a rich and fruitful discussion. I would now like to invite our director, Dr. Beverly Ann Carter, to introduce our distinguished speaker.
Okay. Question two. It's an exam. Question two in the examination of December 1994. In the course L50A, Methods in TESOL, which took place on Friday, December 9th, 1994, this was question two. Kumaravadivelu, 1994, lists 10 macro strategies in his strategic framework for L2 teaching. Maximize learning opportunities, facilitate negotiated interaction, minimize perceptual mismatches, activate intuitive heuristics, foster language awareness, contextualize linguistic input, integrate language skills, promote learner autonomy, raise cultural consciousness, ensure social relevance. December 1994. Little could I imagine that 24 years later, we would have the pleasure to host on our campus Professor Kumar. Who is B. Kumar? Professor Kumar was educated at the Universities of Madras in his native India, at Lancaster in Britain, and at Michigan in the USA. The people in the field of applied linguistics would know these are top-flight universities in our field. So you get some measure of this international scholar, undergraduate and graduate degrees in India, graduate degree from the University of Lancaster, and culminating with his PhD at the University of Michigan. Professor Kumar is currently professor at San Jose State University in California. His areas of research include language teaching methods, teacher education, classroom discourse analysis, post-method pedagogy, and cultural globalization. As an international scholar, he is high in demand both in the US and internationally, serving on the board of prestigious journals such as TESOL Quarterly, conducting consultancies and workshops in countries ranging from Mexico to Colombia, Beijing, Indonesia, Singapore, Hong Kong. He has delivered plenaries all across the globe, from Australia to Brazil, Finland to South Korea, Malaysia to Turkey, Taiwan. So you see, we are talking about international high-flying scholar, someone of great repute. His scholarly work has been documented in many refereed publications and 4 books: Beyond Methods, Macro Strategies for Language Teaching in Yale University Press imprint, Understanding Language Teaching from Method to Post-Method, that was in 2006, Cultural Globalization and Language Education, also Yale University Press in 2008, and Language Teacher Education for a Global Society, Routledge 2012. His book, Cultural Globalization and Language Education, was awarded the Kenneth W. Mildenberg Prize for Outstanding Research Publication by the Modern Language Association of the US. Another book, Language Teacher Education for a Global Society, was shortlisted in 2013 for Outstanding Book of the Year by the British Association of Applied Linguistics. Of him, it has been said, few writers are as capable as Kumara Vadivelu of engendering in a reader that feeling that you are in the hands of a thoughtful and always thought-provoking guide. Professor Kumara is known as a thoughtful voice and a critical one. He's reputed to warn his students at the beginning of the semester that no one's culture is safe from reproach in his class. Professor Kumar is working on his latest book on identity and has promised to share with us his research and critical analysis via a lecture entitled Identity and Identity Formation in a Globalized and Digitalized Society. It gives me tremendous pleasure to begin our 20th anniversary celebrations in earnest with an academic lecture by Professor B. Kumar coming to us from San Jose State University. Please welcome Professor Kumar.
Dean Dr. Heather Ketchup, Director Beverly Ann Carter, distinguished members of the faculty, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I am pleased to participate in the celebrations of the 20th anniversary of the Center for Language Learning. In the last 20 years, the center has made significant contributions in helping students develop not only communicative competence in foreign languages, but also intercultural competence, which is very crucial in these days of globalization. I heartily commend the faculty and the staff of the center, especially its dynamic leader, Professor Cotton. In the last 2 years of my contact, I found that Professor Cotton is a person who never takes a no for an answer. And I thank him very much for inviting me to deliver the first public lecture as part of this 20-year celebrations. And I want to use this opportunity to share with you some of my thoughts on identity and identity formation in a globalized and digitalized society. Why did I choose this topic? Just look around. Identity has become a watchword, a catchword, everywhere. It crystallizes the anxieties, fears, conflicts, tensions that many parts of the world are faced with today. Because of globalization, many nations, communities, and peoples are confronted with real or perceived threats to their linguistic identity, cultural identity, and religious identity, and all of them are fiercely engaged in protecting and preserving their own identities. In Europe, there has recently been a surge in right-wing political parties that are successfully exploiting matters of identity for narrow political gains. Independence Party in Britain, National Front in France, Alternatives for Germany or AfD in Germany, Freedom Party in Austria, Golden Dawn in Greece, People's Party in Denmark, just to name a few. Prime Minister Theresa May is struggling with the aftermath of Brexit, which has clearly been linked to British identity crisis. Chancellor Angela Merkel lost her majority in the Bundestag because her immigration policies were seen as a threat to German identity. In seeking French presidency, Emmanuel Macron had to face a fierce challenger in the far-right leader Marine Le Pen, who promised to restore French identity, and she captured 33% of the votes. One out of three French voters preferred her. In America, the perceived threat to white American identity largely propelled an unlikely candidate, Donald Trump, into the White House. In China, General Secretary Xi Jinping, in his speech at the recent 19th Congress of the Communist Party, highlighted Chinese identity as he laid out the details of what he called Chinese dream. In India, Prime Minister Modi's ruling party successfully campaigned about a nationalist version of Indian identity. Ethnic cleansing is still going on in Myanmar because some of their leaders and citizens feel that the Rohingya community is a blot on their national identity. Terrorist organizations like Al-Qaeda and ISIS flourished because they underscored Islamic identity. Coming closer home, just 3 years ago, the government of Trinidad and Tobago felt the need to publish the National Identity Guidelines. In spite of its importance and widespread use, very few people understood what identity actually means and how it is formed or reformed. Two popular terminologies have caused greater misunderstanding about the concept of identity. One is Facebook identity, and the other is identity theft. As you all know, Facebook is the most popular social network in the world. It appears as if The whole world is on Facebook. My 20-something daughter often tells me that if you are not on Facebook, you don't exist. In spite of her admonishing, I continue to non-exist. According to your report, Facebook now has about 2.1 million active users. That's roughly one out of four people living on this planet. When it was founded in 2004, the company's original goal was just to help people connect with friends. But within 5 years, its CEO and founder, Mark Zuckerberg, considered that Facebook users not merely keeping up with their friends, but they are also building an image, an identity for themselves, which in a sense is their brand. In building a brand for themselves, some Facebook users deceptively portray different images of themselves by creating fake profiles and fake identities. Among the 2 billion active users, roughly 100 million are estimated to have false profiles. Zuckerberg has repeatedly reminded them that they should have only one Facebook identity, their real identity. The fact is, even people who use their real name and create only one Facebook identity can easily embellish their profile and present an imagined persona which is at variance with who they really are. It seems that people use Facebook to try out different identities until they find one that gets a satisfying number of likes. The other expression that's even more problematic is identity theft. I often get cautionary notifications from my bank, credit card companies, and others that I should protect my cards against what they call identity theft. I never thought that by stealing my ID cards, one can steal my identity. Let's be clear. The cards in my wallet are not my identity markers. They are my identification markers. It's true. Bad people can steal my identification, but they cannot steal my identity. Sadly, the mix-up between these two closely related words, identity and identification, is quite common among the public and pundits alike. What my ID cards do is to identify me in terms of my name, affiliation, number, etc. What they do not do is to reveal the core of my identity, the essence of my being. The criminals who steal my cards may deplete my bank balance, forge my driver's license, and do other illegal activities, but they can never, ever steal the faith I follow, the culture I practice, the languages I speak, the beliefs I hold, the values I cherish, the feelings I harbor, the promises I keep, the hopes I nurture, the fears I hide, the struggles I wage, the pain I endure, the pleasures I enjoy. These are some of the things that constitute my identity. My identity, therefore, cannot be miniaturized into a pocket-sized plastic card with a coded magnetic strip. My ID cards cannot be used or abused to strip me of that which makes me me. These two expressions, Facebook identity and identity theft, distort and trivialize the concept of identity, which by any means is deep and dense. Scholars have been wrestling with the complexity of identity and identity formation for a long, long time. It has been explored in as varied academic disciplines as sociology, anthropology, psychology, philosophy, political science, linguistics, and literature. You would imagine that with such exalted and extended scrutiny, scholars would have reached a consensus about what constitutes identity or how it is formed or reformed. That's just not the case. Identity continues to be, as the Australian sociologist Anthony Elliott laments, one of the most vexing and vexed topics in the social sciences and humanities. Vexing or not, we must try to grasp the meaning of identity because, as the American psychologist Eric Erickson once said, in the social jungle of human existence, there is no feeling of being alive without a sense of identity. We should understand our own identity so that we can have a sense of being alive, so that we can know who we are. Who are we actually? We cannot even begin to address this perennial and puzzling question without a clear understanding of our sense of self. That's the reason why the concept of self has captured the imagination of saints and sages down the ages. The Greek philosophers who laid the foundation for Western civilization thought it fit to inscribe the maxim, "Know thyself," at the entry of the temple of Apollo at Delphi. Pythagoras of Samos put it succinctly, "Know thyself, then thou shalt know the universe and God." Indian scriptures such as the Bhagavad Gita stressed that in order to recognize the glory of the Supreme Being, we must first seek the glory of the self. Ancient sages had the wisdom to see an invisible, an inviolable connection between our microcosmic self and the macrocosmic forces above and beyond us. Self-identity is commonly associated with the question, who am I? The question is so simple and yet so profound. It hides the complexity of identity. It's too vague and elusive to make sense. That's why psychologist Erickson says, nobody asks this question except in a morbid state or a creative self-confrontation. According to him, the pertinent question would be, what do I want to make of myself? And what do I have to work with? Similarly, Canadian philosopher Charles Taylor tells us that the question, who am I, can't necessarily be answered by giving name and genealogy. What does answer this question for us is an understanding of what is of crucial importance to us. Those are the questions we need to ask. What do I want to make of myself? What do I have to work with? What's crucially important to me? Each of us will answer these questions differently. And we will answer them differently at different stages in our life. If you are serious about seeking answers to these questions, we must first understand the concept of identity. The term identity stems from the Latin root idiom, idem, meaning the same, as you know. Broadly speaking, our identity entails membership in one or more categories, such as nation, ethnicity, race, religion, class, profession, or gender. Each of these and other categories that mark our identity relates us in some way to other members of the same category, because people in a particular category are generally expected to share characteristics in common. Being a Trinidadian Christian female, for instance, connects one with the shared aspects of Trinidadianness, Christianness, and femaleness, however we choose to define them. We all inherit some typological identities, such as racial or ethnic identity, and we acquire some others, like professional identity. The identity labels we use create certain expectations in others, certain stereotypes about others, using which they measure us up, though superficially and stereotypically. The moment I am introduced as a professor, people may associate me with what they think an academic is, such as someone who gives long and boring lectures. Although sameness is a crucial element of identity, it is difference that most often stands out in proclaiming and projecting our identity. In fact, identity presupposes difference. Most often we characterize somebody's identity in terms of how different that person is from somebody else. Each of us can justifiably say, I am who I am because I am not you. Or in the words of the French writer Amin Maalouf, my identity is what prevents me from being identical to anybody else. Much has been written and continues to be written about identity, variously, in various times, by various people. That's partly because the concept of identity itself varies from time to time. One way of understanding it is to look at it through the lens of the sociological narratives of self-identity associated with three broad periods of time history, human history: pre-modern, modern, and post-modern. I find no consensus among historians or sociologists as to the exact time period of these three isms. For several scholars, though pre-modern refers to a period prior to mid-17th century, modern refers to a period roughly from mid-17th to late 20th century, and post-modern to a period roughly from late 20th onwards. And that's the time frame I will be using. In order to put the identity in proper historical perspective, I will begin with a review of the philosophical systems of postmodernism, modernism, and premodernism, as prevailed in Western intellectual thought. Briefly speaking, the three isms define and describe significant growth and development in Western civilization, as reflected in science and humanities, in politics and religion, as well as in art and architecture. During the pre-modern times, that's prior to mid-17th century, almost no scientific temper existed. A theological worldview predominated. Faith prevailed over reason. It was believed that knowledge about ultimate truth was obtainable only through divine revelation coming from a god or gods. Sacred texts such as the Bible were authentic and authoritative sources of knowledge. Leaders of the Catholic Church were considered to be the sole custodians, interpreters, and purveyors of knowledge. They wielded enormous power and influence over the ruling class, that's mostly kings and feudal lords, as well as over the common people. For these and other reasons, the pre-modern period has been rightly characterized as medieval or feudal. It took a very, very long time, centuries actually, for a different worldview to evolve. To a large extent, the gradual evolution was the cause, as well as the consequence, of modernity. The modern period, remember, roughly from mid-17th to late 20th, witnessed fundamental transformations in almost all walks of life, triggered predominantly by developments in two major areas of human activity, science and religion. Experimental science, based on newly developed scientific methods, led to a treasure house of empirically verifiable knowledge systems. It was during the early decades of the modern period that scientists discovered new knowledge on an unprecedented scale and in major branches of science: Galileo Galilei in astronomy, Isaac Newton in physics, Carl Linnaeus in biology, Antoine Lavoisier in chemistry, just to name a few. The scientific theories of the early modern period, particularly the 17th and 18th centuries, along with the importance given to logic and reason, contributed significantly to the weakening of the power and influence of the Catholic Church. The church leaders could not ignore scientific methods introduced during this period and felt compelled to use them to reinterpret and reformulate certain aspects of Christian theology. As a result, the church had to slowly and grudgingly concede some of its intellectual authority to scholars and universities and its political authority to the rulers of the time. The emphasis on logic and reason that marked the scientific temper of the early period was also nurtured by another movement, Enlightenment. European Enlightenment generated lofty ideas such as liberty, fraternity, equality, tolerance, individualism, separation of church and the state. These ideas severely undermined the authority of the monarchy and of the church, sowing the seeds for two prominent socio-political revolutions in the West, the American Revolution and the French Revolution, both of which opened up the floodgates of liberal democracy and individual freedom. There is no doubt that the modern period heralded the ideals of liberal democracy, free market economy, individual liberty, and human rights. But it has another side, a darker side. The same period witnessed colonialism and imperialism that oppressed a vast number of countries and peoples in Asia, Africa, and in South America. The scourge of major wars, World War I and II, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, the Gulf War, and the scars they left caused untold human misery. The same period also witnessed poverty, economic inequality, racial conflicts, and gender discrimination on a larger scale. The failure of modernity to ensure freedom and equality, peace and prosperity for all, caused widespread disillusionment. It eventually resulted in the denunciation of some of the modernist thoughts and in the emergence of postmodern views. The postmodern period, that is late 20th onwards, is still in its infancy. And yet, it has already experienced socio-political upheavals arising out of people's deep resentment about the modernist project that relied excessively, some would say obsessively, on privatization, deregulation, and free trade. Many countries witnessed a socio-political unrest, which came as a surprise to many politicians and pundits. But postmodernist social theories, led by the celebrated trio of French thinkers, Michel Foucault, Jean-François Lyotard, and Jacques Derrida, predicted the ill effects of modernism quite a long ago. For these and other European thinkers, the pre-modern is the realization of the hubris of modernity. They saw debilitating disconnections between the laudable goals of modernism and the deplorable outcomes it generated. More specifically, they cautioned against the excesses of capitalism that trampled upon the lives of the working class men and women. They chided the hypocrisy of liberal democracies that buttressed oppressive regimes around the world to safeguard their own national interest. They lamented the jingoistic voices of nationalism that impeded harmonious relationship between nations and peoples. They alerted individuals, communities, and nations to emerging globalism that demands concerted and coordinated actions. That, in a nutshell, is how Western intellectual thought unfolded, as I see it. Let me add a note of caution here. Although there are three identifiable developmental phases with an approximate time period attached to each of these isms, it's not as if one period neatly ends before the next one begins. Besides, not all the societies, not all the communities within the society march happily and ceremoniously from one period to another in a lockstep fashion. In the 21st century, one can easily come across some of the salient features of all three isms overlapping and coexisting within a nation or even within a community. Take America, for instance. Contemporary American society is mostly modern. Individualism, a cardinal tenet of modernism, is also America's core value. Its liberal democracy, its free market economy, its religious freedom, its scientific temper, its technological prowess, its constitutional separation of church and state, all these testify to its modernist credentials. We also witness in America clear signs of postmodern outlook. The heightened awareness about income inequality that permeated the 2016 presidential election, the greater acceptance of gay rights that culminated in the 2015 Supreme Court decision to declare same-sex marriage a constitutional right, the increased recognition of ethnic group consciousness that expresses itself in terms of identity politics, the widespread realization about how global issues such as climate change can easily impact on our daily life, these are but a few postmodern thoughts enveloping the American society today. But at the same time, certain pre-modern traditions tinged with religious, racial, and gender discrimination continue to linger even in the 21st century America. Let me cite a few examples. Just in the last 20 years, the country witnessed more than 4,700 fire incidents at various places of worship, churches, synagogues, mosques, temples. Nearly half of these fires were ruled intentional. High school proms in the Deep South were racially segregated into the white folks' prom and the black folks' prom. Some popular golf clubs systematically excluded female members until as recently as 2012. The historic election of an African American twice as President of the United States failed miserably to usher in a post-racial America. These are not isolated examples. These are symptomatic of a prevailing pre-modern mindset that prevails even in an advanced country like the USA. Well, some of you may be wondering, what is all these historical narratives to do with identity? Quite a lot. The central point is this. Each ism is at once the result of and resulted in certain historical and socio-political environment that unfailingly and undeniably shaped and reshaped the concept of self-identity. Allow me to peep into each of them once again, this time with particular reference to identity. What is pre-modern identity? In the pre-modern society, the individual perpetually lived in a state of feudal subordination, which determined the individual's personal identity and identity formation. During this period, the freedom enjoyed by the individual to conceive and construct his or her own identity was so minimal or even non-existent that self-identity was described as selfless identity. That's because an individual's identity was tied almost inseparably to affiliation to family and to ethnic community. Individuals were required to strictly follow the prevailing socio-cultural beliefs and practices, as well as religious rites and rituals, all of which consigned them and confined them to a neatly delineated, religiously dictated, socially approved, hierarchically coded place under the sun. Pre-modern individuals had to take on a community identity, a collective identity. Deprived of an opportunity to develop personalized identity, they had to find fulfillment within the boundaries of pre-existing and relatively unchanging societal norms. In other words, the pre-modern sense of self was externally imposed on individuals, then self-constructed by them. More than anything else, it was deliberately designed to keep them in their neat little place. The message conveyed to them by their family and by the community was as simple as it was stern. You are born there, you belong there, you better stay there. If you cross the boundaries, there will be consequences. So such a condition existed for a long time until a different concept of identity emerged during the modern period. In sharp contrast to the pre-modern view of identity, the modern view privileges the individual. It bestows on the individuals certain fundamental rights to define who they are. It concedes their freedom to exercise their agency, that is, their ability and responsibility and willingness to make the right choice and to make the right action needed to shape their own identity. It sees self-identity as something that's actively and continually constructed by the individual on an ongoing basis. In this never-ending process of constructing self-identity, individuals are constantly called upon to make commitments and judgments about everyday events and experiences. Yet another characteristic of modern identity is that it's considered multiple and fragmented. Clearly, all of us play several roles in the practice of everyday life. Each role carries with it a fragment, only a fragment of who we are. Take me, for example. What are some of the roles I play every day? I'm a son, I'm a brother, I'm a husband, I'm a father, I'm a friend, I'm a professor, I'm an author, and more. Depending on the context, a particular facet of my identity is foregrounded. When I stand before you giving this lecture, it's my professorial identity that comes to the fore. When I accompany my son to his badminton training and tournament, it's my parental identity that stands out. When I help my wife with household chores, believe me, I do that too. Other aspects of my identity are displayed. Even though each of these identity fragments appears to be discrete in its function, modernists would say that all of them are in fact seamlessly connected to my sense of self. A person's identity, as Amin Maalouf explains, it's not an assemblage of separate affiliations, not a kind of loose patchwork. It's like a pattern drawn on the tightly stretched parchment. Touch just one part of it, just one allegiance, and the whole person will react. The whole drum will sound. Unlike modern identity, which marked a drastic departure from the pre-modern identity, post-modern identity is in many ways the continuation of modern identity, but with a consequential twist. Postmodern identity does accept the essence of individuality. However, it decenters the individual. Wary of the excesses of individualism and its attendant tendency to sidetrack common good, postmodern identity stresses the importance of collectivity, community. It maintains that individuals are not as autonomous as they appear to be or they want to be. And hence they can hardly form any meaningful self-identity without taking into consideration the prevailing historical, political, social, and economic conditions. Group affiliations based on religion, race, class, or gender have become an important aspect of postmodern life. Group consciousness has grown significantly in the late 20th and early 21st century. In the US 2016 presidential election, perhaps more fragrantly than in previous elections, identity politics played a consequential role. The Republicans amplified white identity politics, while the Democrats amplified the group identities of everybody else, women, African Americans, Asian Americans, Hispanics, LGBT community, etc. I don't have to tell you about the identity politics that plays out in political and social lives of Afro-Trinidadians, Indo-Trinidadians, and other ethnic communities in this country. In spite of the focus on group allegiance, postmodern identity is seen as a globalist identity. It demands that people go even beyond group affiliations, as well as national attachments, and take a global perspective in their attempt to construct their self-identity. The ongoing processes of globalization and digitalization have created a world that is more interconnected than ever before in human history. Postmodern identity formation, therefore, requires that individuals equip themselves with the knowledge, skill, and the disposition necessary to make informed judgments about who they are and who they want to be in a globalized society. In becoming globally aware, individuals may encounter political systems, religious beliefs, cultural practices that are antithetical to their own. The extent to which they are able and willing to understand and cope with these conflicts and contradictions and use them to enrich their own lives will largely shape their postmodern identity. Because postmodern identity formation is riddled with conflicts and contradictions, individuals are faced with challenges they have never before encountered in life. They have to grapple with something that's unstable, something that's amorphous, something that is incomplete. As a result, they are compelled to endlessly invent and reinvent their self-identity. To do so, they can hardly depend on traditional ways of thinking and acting, because these are fast becoming outmoded. They are left to navigate their own paths, stumbling, learning, evolving along the way. In short, the contemporary society has presented individuals with what Jacques Derrida calls the disorder of identity. The disorder of identity has been causing, as noted by the British sociologist Anthony Giddens, a high level of insecurity in the individuals, mainly because they have no choice but to choose how to act and how to be. Whether we like it or not, whether we want it or not, we are all entangled in an intricate web of interlocution that teaches us important lessons. Self doesn't exist without society. Individuality doesn't exist without collectivity. If we fail to be responsive to and responsible for social harmony, we will end up facing a spate of identity crisis in our life. In order to navigate self and society, individuals have to understand certain realities that confront them in the 21st century. What actually are these realities? I will briefly outline four of them: global reality, national reality, social reality, and personal reality. What is global reality today? The processes of globalization have been unfolding in three facets: economic, educational, and cultural. Economic globalization is marked by a manifold increase in the international flow of capital, goods, and labor, in the involvement of global financial systems, and in the role of transnational corporations, in foreign direct investments, etc. One unmistakable consequence is that the economic global order that was put in place after the Second World War is fast changing. The domination of the US dollar in the global market is beginning to be challenged, particularly by China. Educational globalization is marked by an expansion of the physical footprint of Ivy League universities as they rush to compete with each other to open overseas campuses. World-renowned consulting firms such as McKinsey and Company are getting increasingly involved in the education sector, studying and making recommendations about global capital investment in local education. In addition, free online courses from universities like Stanford, Yale, MIT, Harvard, Oxford, and others are being made available to students all over the world. In addition to economic and educational globalization, it is cultural globalization that is having a huge impact on identity and identity formation. We are all in closer contact, cultural contact with one another than ever before. Foreign cultures are no longer foreign. Local communities are no longer cultural islands unto themselves. People now have a greater chance of knowing about each other's way of life, the good, the bad, and yes, the ugly. Ironically, the global reality has not only not eclipsed national reality, but has actually magnified it. The idea of a nation state is fairly recent in human history. It was formulated only during the late 18th century. Even though a nation is an imagined community, as Benedict Anderson famously said, the idea of a nation has a magical hold on all of us. It has the capacity to unify people across religion, race, language, class, gender, and other differences that can otherwise tear them apart. There are 193 countries in the world today. Each of them considers its own national identity as something unique, something superior, that has to be defended at all costs. Nationalism, we must realize that nationalism also harbors the vicious forms of oppression, genocide, and ethnic cleansing. That's why the stridency of nationalism, along with several internationalists, such as Rabindranath Tagore, who called nationalism one of the most powerful anesthetics that man has invented. In spite of the fact that nationalism is rising its ugly head again, the global reality has called into question the vibrancy of nation states and the viability of national identities. Historians such as David Held and Eric Hobsbawm believe that globalization has weakened the sovereignty of nation states so much that it's now a mere ghost of what once it was. They point out that sovereign states have become decision takers rather than decision makers. The decision-making authority vested in supranational institutions such as the United Nations, the International Court of Justice, the World Trade Organization bears testimony to their assertion. The relative weakening of the nation state has resulted in at least two consequential developments. First, nations are energetically engaged in preserving and protecting their own cultural heritage. French sociologist Michel Desarto anticipated this to some extent when he asserted that to the homogenization of economic structures, there must be a corresponding diversification of cultural expressions and institutions. The more the economy unifies, the more culture must be variegated. Second, marginalized local cultures and subcultures are becoming more and more assertive and are fighting for independent status. In a referendum conducted in 2014, Scotland almost voted to become an independent country. Some Scottish leaders have promised to try again. In an election conducted just a few weeks ago, Catalonian pro-independence parties secured a renewed majority in the Catalan parliament, keeping alive their hope of separation from Spain. What about social reality? It manifests itself in the markers of identity that bind members of community together. Out of these affiliations emerge a community's shared values and beliefs, as well as shared norms of interpretation that help its members derive meaning out of myths, reason out of rituals, and sense out of symbols. Social affiliations are so important for individual identity that sociologist Richard Jenkins says, all human identities are by definition social identities. Communities such as Latinos or Jews in the US, Scots and Irish in the UK, Hindus or Muslims in India, Afro-Trinidadians and Indo-Trinidadians in this country all have their own way of life, their places of worship, their social organizations. In other words, each community creates and protects its own social reality. Whenever there is a real or perceived threat to this social reality, social unrest erupts. Yet another social reality we witness is that globalization has not contributed to the expansion of shared values among the people of a community or of a nation, even though it has certainly contributed to the contraction of space, time, and borders. If anything, it has only strengthened the forces of fundamentalism, which has been characterized as a child of globalization. Fundamentalism, whether it is a Buddhist, a Christian, Hindu, or Islamic, or of any other persuasion, is premised upon a deep desire to protect and preserve their particular religious beliefs and practices that are perceived to be threatened by cultural, global cultural flaws. It's within this complicating social reality that an individual has to create and maintain his or her own personal identity. The personal identity today is much more complex than it has ever before, ever been. Because of economic, educational, and cultural globalization, a person is beset with a bewildering array of challenges and opportunities. As Giddens points out, for the first time in human history, self and society are interrelated in a global milieu. As the pressure from the centrifugal and centripetal forces of globalization grows, and as the relative security of tradition and custom slowly recedes to the back, individuals will be finding themselves using their own agentive role more and more. In their accelerated attempt to exercise their agency, they may come across artificial boundaries imposed upon them by vested interests. They have to develop the ability and willingness to transgress those boundaries in order to create and recreate self-identity in a meaningful way. They have to recognize that transgression is a prerequisite for transformation. Clearly, the global, national, social, and personal realities are all interconnected. They shape and reshape each other in a synergic relationship where the whole is much more than the sum of the parts. It is this dialectical relationship that is now influencing identity formation in our globalized world. What's functioning as an engine that drives this dialectical relationship is internetization and its technological twin, digitalization. Aided by the internet, the digital interface has revolutionized business models, marketing techniques, customer relations, etc. The new information technology that carries cultural images around the world also carries most needed knowledge. The global communication network makes available for millions of people around the world many tools they can use to advance their own knowledge. Anybody who has access to the internet, whether a school kid in Trinidad, or a farmer in India, or an investment banker in Hong Kong, or a research scholar at Oxford, all of them can access valuable information they want and need. The lives of all people all over the world are more intensely and more instantly connected than ever before. Whether we are aware of it or not, we are all caught in a microscopic mesh in a global web. Given the global and social national environment that I just outlined, the question arises, how can an individual shape his or her own personal identity? It's my contention that in this age of globalization and digitalization, the edifice of a meaningful identity can be constructed and reconstructed on a strong foundation of what I have called global cultural consciousness. Developing global cultural consciousness is a complex process that requires, more than anything else, continual critical self-reflection. As the Nobel laureate Amartya Sen observes, proper understanding of the world of plural identities requires clarity of thinking about the recognition of our multiple commitments and affiliations. Decolonization of the mind demands a firm departure from the temptation of solitary identities and priorities. I wish to emphasize that what guides us in the development of global cultural consciousness is our own value system, sedimented from our own inherited cultural traditions. Our learned knowledge and lived experience of other cultures not only expand our cultural horizon, but also clarify and solidify our inherited cultural heritage. In understanding other cultures, we understand our own better. In understanding our own, we understand other cultures better. When we use this deep understanding in a meaningful way, we will culturally grow and enrich our lives. In this context, educators, regardless of what subjects they teach, have a special responsibility to help their students develop global cultural consciousness. This is particularly true of language educators. As Chris Whedon points out, actual and possible forms of social organization and their likely social and political consequences are defined and contested. Yet it's also the place where our sense of ourselves and our subjectivity is constructed. To help our learners decolonize their mind, we have to help them function as self-regulating individuals, capable of receiving, understanding, exchanging, and judging cultural information that is bombarding them almost on a daily basis. We have to teach them how to differentiate between ideas and ideologies, between information and disinformation, between the trivial and the consequential, and to use the newly popularized term between news and fake news. To develop such a discerning mind, they surely need critical knowledge. The information technology has made such knowledge base available to those individuals who seek it. Using the knowledge base and engaging in critical self-reflection, individuals now have the opportunity to evaluate their and other cultures' value systems and develop global cultural consciousness. If we are serious about preparing our students to face the challenges of the 21st century, we must help them learn to form and reform their identity in a meaningful way. We must make them aware that there is no one culture in the world that embodies all that is good. There is no one culture in the world that embodies all that is bad. Every culture has something to be proud of, and every culture has something to be ashamed of. I have all along believed that one's cultural growth should be rooted in one's own cultural tradition. but must also be enriched by an ability and a willingness to learn not only about other cultures, but also from other cultures. Learning about other cultures merely leads us to cultural literacy. It's learning from other cultures that will lead us to cultural liberty. I have borrowed the idea of rootedness and openness from a well-known Indian. I'm referring to Mahatma Gandhi and his oft-quoted statement, "I do not want my house to be walled in on all sides and my windows to be stuffed. I want the culture of all lands to be blown about my house as freely as possible, but I refuse to be blown off by my feet by any." Ladies and gentlemen, let's plant our feet firmly on our own cultural soil. But at the same time, let's remember to keep our windows wide open. Thank you very much.
Professor Kumar, thank you so much. That was indeed a thought-provoking public lecture. Wow. No, you're going to speak. No. Now I would like to invite Dr. Sandra Hobbs. She is a lecturer in French here at the Center for Language Learning, and she is going to lead the question and answer period and the open discussion, the discussion that now opens the floor for you to bring your questions.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Kumar, for that very stimulating talk. You touched on so many things and on so many different disciplines, in fact. I'm sure that there is a wealth of questions awaiting you from the auditorium. Raise your hand, don't be shy. Perhaps you need time to formulate your questions. I couldn't help but think in the last section of your talk, when you were discussing how the individual can navigate through the conflicting and multiple choices facing them. And I couldn't help but think of the concept of hegemony. And Chomsky seems more and more relevant as every day goes by. And I'm wondering if you could briefly touch on how hegemony might prevent the individual from navigating those conflicting and differing options in the global cultural minefield that they are placed in.
All right. So we have only one mic here?
I think so.
When I think of hegemony, more than Chomsky, I think of Gramsci, who has written quite deeply about hegemony and subalternity. In my talk, I said we need to help our students, help all of us, to transgress some of the boundaries, artificial boundaries imposed on us. And even I stated that transgression, as I see it, is a prerequisite for transformation. So when you talk about, you know, what is it that we can do, the first thing that we need to help our students to understand that pretty much all aspects of their lives, with very few exceptions, is being controlled by forces outside of them. The first thing that they have to do is to understand what exactly are these historical, political, social, and also religious forces that are actually suppressing them and preventing them from realizing their fullest human potential. And that's not going to be easy, because we have decolonized most of the countries and territories. Decolonizing a territory is fairly easy, but decolonizing the human mind is not. So how are we going to help our students to decolonize their human mind? As I said, we need to create in them the capacity to reflect self-critically about themselves, about their community, and about their society. And it's not an easy task, and it's not going to happen overnight. But at the same time, we need to persist slowly, gradually, hoping that one day light will dawn upon them.
I think it's a good reminder to remain optimistic about the power that we do have to, as educators, to inspire our students to think more critically mm-hmm. of the forces that shape not just our world, but them. Perhaps someone in the audience has had a chance to, Madam, would you like to come up and use the microphone, or would you prefer to just?
I think I can project.
Okay, I think
good.
You can.
Yes. Good evening, Professor Kumar. I really enjoyed the lecture presentation, and I felt that it triggered a lot of thoughts in my head. But as you were giving the response there, the question that I was initially going to ask has kind of changed. I want you to use yourself then as an example and talk about the steps to decolonization, because I think that's using Trinidad and Tobago as a for example. I see us as a space that we have multiple cultures here, and there is a resistance still in 2018 to wanting to know about the other cultures that are right here, and moving from knowing about cultures to being liberated by knowledge of different cultures, right? So there are lots of tensions that ought not to be there, I think, if we understood each other's cultures properly. So how do you then go about decolonizing your mind so that you get to the point where you are open to learning about and embracing and learning from other cultures?
Well, that is definitely a difficult task. I think the best thing as educators, whenever we meet with our students in our classes, we need to make sure that not only we practice critical self-reflection, but we should also tell them the importance of that. Let me tell you this. Every time I offer a graduate seminar, on the very first day, I give my students a two-part sentence. And I end my semester recalling the same two-part sentence. And it goes like this. Do not blindly accept everything I say. And do not hastily reject anything I say. If you think about it, there's no contradiction there. And all I'm trying to say is, keep your mind open. And you will see in whatever you are reading, particularly in the fields of humanities and social sciences, you will see some kind of a writer bias. In fact, I tell them that there is no writing in humanities and social sciences that is unbiased. So the first thing that they have to do when they read something, when we give them to read something, is to identify the writer bias and think about where the writer is coming from. What exactly is the political bias? What exactly is the ideological inner bias? So one way of helping them decolonize their own mind is to show them how we are actually practicing that, you know, in our own classroom. And that will take a tremendous effort, because I have come across several students, because of their previous schooling, they have pretty much set their mind about XYZ. And if you try to tell them something different, there is resistance. And as teachers, it's our responsibility to break that resistance and try to help them, you know, go beyond that. And all those things can be done, but it can be done only gradually and painfully, you know, slowly. And every time you give them something to read, select a passage that affords critical interpretation and try to help them understand that what they read is only one perspective on a particular topic. Okay, what exactly are other perspectives? So that's one example of how we as educators can help our students to understand that they have been historically subjugated by vested interests, and they have to be aware of what actually has been happening around them. And one important thing, we talked about identity politics. Politicians, not just in this country, and this country is not an exception, politicians everywhere have the tendency to exploit the identity of individual ethnic communities, pitching one community against another. I cannot think of any country which is an exception to that. So we need to tell our students, particularly during election times, for instance, what exactly is happening there? What is the subtext of what the politicians are saying? And why are they focusing on the importance of one particular ethnic community against another? So these are some of the ways in which we can begin to help our students to think differently, hoping that, as I said earlier, eventually they will change their mind.
Thank you for your complete response. I'm sure there's another question. Dean, Cato?
I enjoyed your lecture. I agree with everything you said. And I think my question is connected to the one that you just asked. I know we can't solve every problem that we have. But I was looking at the lecture and I think the problem is we get these lectures in this kind of setting all the time. The issue is that there's a whole constituency out there that we also have to get this message across to. My solution would be that somehow this has to be broken down into a version that starts at preschool. Because our notions of self and identity start from there. Not everybody's going to reach university where we can, you know, have this kind of discourse. And I think it's critical if we want to see a qualitative change that we do focus on getting messages like this broken down and into domain of that wider constituency. You just have to ride in a maxi taxi in Trinidad and Tobago to understand the extent to which the message has to extend, and it has to be broken down, I think, in a way that somebody out there who may never come to a class and you can begin to identify and change your ideas and thoughts. I think if that does not happen, we can do as much as we can from the university, but we would not have the type of transformation that we want. Mm-hmm.
I noticed that that's a statement, and I fully agree with you. Getting across the right message is a challenge these days, because I know young people particularly, they are listening to all kinds of news and messages from all kinds of social media, and the teachers seem to be playing very little role in trying to help them, in trying to get across the message that you want to. And that is the kind of a challenge that we are faced with as educators. So we cannot ask our youngsters, you know, to throw away their smartphone. They are not going to do it. In fact, I try my best, you know, in my own house, you know, but that's not going to, you know, happen at all. So we have to live, you know, with that. So in addition to that, what the young people are doing, what is it that we can do in the classroom to get across a message? Okay, that's what we need to think about more and more. Okay.
Yeah, the gentleman here, you have a question.
It's a question to see if people can figure out the solutions or the approaches to two challenges. One of them, I think, is endemic to our education system, that because of its highly competitive nature, I immediately think of Japan, about which I know a little bit. Had a little experience of in their education system, that the students are looking for the right answer. And therefore, the whole education process for many of them is, what is the right answer? It's not about thinking it out or looking at other And I see that approach as being totally antithetical to what you are asking people to do. We have this very competitive exam at 11 years old, the SEA. There is the competition to get into sixth form after 5 years, and to some extent, there's the competition to get into the university. And I have a small input into teaching medical students, and that is what we see as their major challenge. They're not interested in other views or let's look at this or so on. What is the right answer? How can I get the best mark? And they simplify it into there is only one. So that is one of my ideas.
We could let Professor Kumar address respond that first.
Well, once again, that's a statement I fully agree with you. But I have come to believe that constraints are part of our life. Can you think of any aspect of our life which does not come with constraints? So I think we need to live with constraints and work with constraints and see what we can do to go beyond those constraints. And I know it is difficult, particularly when students are asking for the right answer. But sometimes I wonder, where are they getting that idea from? Is it because of the system that we have put in place? Is it because of what we do in the classroom? Is it because we are only too willing to give them the right answer instead of saying, hey, I don't know the answer. I don't have the right answer. Let's together converse and see what kind of an answer we can jointly come up with. So my answer to that would be, let's try to change our own instructional methods. And hopefully that will lead to some positive results.
I totally see that.
There's a second part to your question?
Yes. It's again another comment on the absolute, I feel overwhelmed and I almost feel like giving up against the forces of commercialism, planned obsolescence, the strident forms of popular culture, because those seem to be the things that predominate, especially among the young, and shape them in ways which we who feel that there are other values find difficult to combat. And in some ways, you reflected it. To tell a teenager, spend less time on your cell phone and read more. But there are all of these economic forces, I call them that in broad terms, just saying, and the whole idea of if you have, you must have a Samsung 8, you must have the latest. It ties into the human need, I suppose, to feel some kind of sense of being with it and being at least equal, if not superior to everyone else. And I find that a difficult phenomenon to fight against.
I agree with you. These are all philosophical observations and very difficult to find the answer that we like. As I said, the only way that is open to us is to persist with what we think is the right thing to do. And I don't think we should expect instant success in what we do. And I think we should learn more and more to accept a failure of some kind, not necessarily 100%. There will always be a certain percentage of failure, which also means there will be a certain percentage of success. So we have to build on that.
I would like to actually quote from your the biography you shared with us. Your post-method pedagogy seeks to direct language teachers away from knowledge transmission and towards knowledge generation, away from pedagogic dependence and towards pedagogic independence. And that's your words. And you also, at the end of your the information you gave us, suggested that no matter how we teach today, we will be driven to criticize and reinvent our teaching methods tomorrow. And I hope that tonight's talk has helped us towards that goal. Let's take this opportunity to thank Professor Kumar for his wonderful intervention. And I think we'll wrap up tonight's activities with a warm round of applause.
Folks, you understand why I'm so excited about Professor Kumar. You heard him, yes. I am excited and grateful to Professor Kumar because this gentleman today is his 70th birthday. So, for your patience, for your support, for your presence.
Thank you very much.
How many languages can you sing it?
There'll be cake. Wow. But you're not getting cake unless you sing him happy birthday. Oh. So come on. Three, four.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Tablespoon. Oh. Those of us who know tablespoon,
yes.
Great cake. So there's cake outside.